Spirit, come tonight. We open up our hearts. We relinquish our rights tonight. And we pray, let your will be done. Let your kingdom come in our lives, in our family lives, in the midst of whatever's happening in our nation, in the nations of the world. Come and have your way. Come and have your way. Come and have your way. Holy Spirit, come and touch every heart. Touch the lonely this morning. Those that are lonely tonight, touch them. Touch them. The lonely, the poor, the ones that have no one to lean on tonight, touch them. Make yourself so real to them. Breathe resurrection life into them tonight. Into Devasha's sister-in-law, Angeline, resurrection life and power to flow into those areas that are numb tonight. Resurrection life and power flow into her. Holy Spirit, touch tonight. We speak healing to flow rapidly into every part of her body. Amen. And we command that body to begin to be healed and to function normal. Amen. In the name of Jesus.
Yes. Thank you,
Lord. In the name of Lord. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Touch Sylvia. Oh, Sylvia, tonight, Lord God, touch her tonight. Let your holy fire go through her tonight. Let your holy presence touch her tonight. Father, lift up every one of them that need a miracle tonight.
Amen.
Everyone tonight that has spoken out or hasn't said anything, you know which ones need a touch from you. To get a touch from the Lord is so real. Touch them tonight. Holy Spirit, lift off burdens. Lift off burdens. There's burdens. People are carrying burdens. They're carrying members of the family, the burden for. Lift off the burdens. Lift off the heaviness of hearts tonight and let your peace come. Let your peace come tonight. Touch families. Touch individuals. Release finances for those that are crying out for a breakthrough financially. Release finances tonight. Restore the economy of our land. Restore this great south land of the Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost, tonight. We just thank you, Lord, that we can come into your presence. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. Take us deeper. Take us deeper. Deeper than we've ever been before in you. We want to go deeper. Deep is calling. Deep. Deep calls unto deep tonight. There's an altar call tonight. There's deep. You want to go deeper tonight. Hallelujah. Acknowledge that. Acknowledge that. You want to go deeper, saying, yes, Lord, I want to go deeper. I want to go deeper than I've ever gone before. I want to go past the ankle, past the knees, past the thighs. I want to be in the water of God's Spirit, flowing in the river of life tonight, going deeper, deeper, where I can't touch the bottom, going deeper, deeper, breaking through limitations tonight. Take us deeper, take us deeper. There's a whole throng tonight that wants to go deeper, that wants to go deeper, that wants to be immersed in the Spirit of the living God tonight. Take us deeper tonight. Oh, Holy Spirit, touch. Open the eyes tonight. Visions and dreams.
Yes,
visions and dreams. The language of the Holy Spirit. Visions and dreams tonight. Activate, activate, activate the prophetic tonight. Holy Ghost, activate the visions and dreams tonight. Touch families that they will never be the same again.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Praise
yes,
you, Lord.
You,
glory,
Jesus.
Glory. Amen.
Amen. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Anyone sense anything during our worship tonight? You sense, you seen a vision? You feeling something? You were sensing God moving during worship?
Yara, I felt like a sense of softness, like it was like I was encased in cotton wool. It was a very soft, It just felt really comfortable and soft.
Thank you, Jesus.
Awesome. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for sharing that.
The Holy Spirit moves in different ways.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. Just receive. Thank you, Lord. It's the power of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Can't get any better than that. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Anyone else? Some people will feel like oil pouring into them, in their hands and their feet. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Wesley had something.
Yes, Wesley.
Yeah, Pastor Yara, as you were saying, we're waiting on you. I was thinking, as we're waiting on the Lord, we're taking the time to perfect our love for you, to perfect our praise and worship for you. We are waiting on you, Father God. Praise his holy name.
Mm. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes, that came with such love. Yes, awesome, Wesley. Praise the Lord. I'm just sensing tonight that the Spirit of God is unlocking some things that have been locked.
Mm.
Unlocking things. Hallelujah.
Miss Belinda.
Yeah, I just really feel God softening my heart in areas that need to be softened. There's a real melting in that, in the spirit in my heart. Through worship in this time, and it's good.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Awesome.
Amen.
Awesome. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Soft and tender heart.
You need to be broken before God, a broken and a contrite heart. You will not despise. Thank you, Lord. Broken before your King.
Mm.
Anyone else?
Man.
It's Janet.
Yeah, just after this morning's meeting, just all day I just had this heat running through my body, up and down the whole time, and particularly in an area in my back, and it's still there. It hasn't moved. So praise God.
Praise God. Amen. There were other people who called me as well this morning. It was very powerful. From the time, you know, Amariah started singing, the Holy Ghost moved from that time on, and Yara's message as well. Anyone else?
Good evening. I feel like what you said, Pastor Yara, just with that unlocking, and it's like just tonight I feel like I can see things differently. Just differently again. Like something it's like it's broadened. It's like added another layer onto what I was seeing, but just I can see from, like, it feels like I'm looking from the top of a mountain as opposed to looking up towards the mountain, and then the view is skewed. But now it's like there's just something I can see differently tonight. Amen.
Wow. That's awesome. God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. It's like when we're seated with him in heavenly places. Amen. We have a better vision. We have a better view of things when we're high up. Amen. That's good, Emma. Javan had something.
Yeah, I just through the worship just felt an overwhelming sense of comfort, like just the Lord's comfort and softness coming over myself too. Just removing burdens and heavy backpacks. So yeah, praise God.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes, those beautiful songs do soften your heart, and they're just awesome, and I love them. It just your heart just melts. It's just so powerful, those words. Yes, amen.
Sister, I wasn't going to share because I was waiting to see if God's going to expand it a bit more, but I just have been seeing these dark clouds, and I see the light coming through the clouds, but very slowly, and God just sort of, I first thought he was just showing it to me that there's always light, even though the clouds are dark, there's always light shining at the on the other side of the dark clouds. There's always light, the light never goes away. So when you spoke about the unlocking, I sort of thought that's what he's actually showing, that even though the clouds are dark, the light's breaking through. So it's just that I was seeing. Yeah.
Amen, that's right. The sun's always shining on the other side, even though the clouds hide it. The sun is always there. It doesn't remove the sun. It's always there, the light of God's presence. Amen, he's always there.
I just wanted to share the songs for tonight actually came about from one of the transformation meetings this week, and we were talking about fears and everything, and it was something Yara said, and it was just a short little a bit, and I'm not very good at speaking word for word what was said, but it was basically, if we know God, we need to know him. When we know him, when we truly know him, we can truly trust him. And then our fears can be dealt with, because if we truly trust God, then we don't have any room to fear.
Amen.
So all of those songs tonight, that what was said the other day sent me on a quest to know God, sent me on a quest to know him deeper. And that's what it was all about, to know him deeper.
Yeah.
I actually found a little book that I had on my shelf called To Know Him by Gloria Copeland, and I've not read too much of it, but it is so powerful.
Yeah.
And we need to come into that place where we can have that greater depth of relationship with him, where we truly know him so much. We have such an intimacy with him. It's becoming intimate, that intimate relationship with him, so that we can fully trust him, no matter what is going on in the world, no matter what's going on in our families, we can fully trust him. And I think I'm getting into trouble for stealing the word, so I'll say no more.
That's an awesome word, Maureen. That's really an hour word. Amen. That's so important. Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you for sharing that. Hallelujah. And I love that sent you on a quest to go deeper in the things of God. I love that. That is just awesome. You're so inspiring, so encouraging. God bless you.
Amen. The greatest thing in all my life
is knowing him.
Thank you, Lord. You know, yes. Paul said that I may know you.
Yes.
A man of that standard could say, I may know the power of your resurrection.
Yeah.
And the fellowship of your suffering. Once you know him, there is no fear. And your confidence is in God. Mm. Your assurance is in God. Your trust is in God.
Yeah.
Everything is in Him. Mm. If anyone or anything has taken you outside that presence, you need to get back again. But yeah. Thank God He's given you a new and a living way to get back in there again.
Mm.
Wherever you lost your cutting edge. Mm. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. When people don't receive their healing, I take them into a place where they lost their healing, and they're back again and they get instantly healed. Thank you, Lord. Are we ready to take communion today? Which what's going around church, be careful about this. You get all sorts of emails, and some of them you don't know whether they're even things on Facebook and and all sorts of stories, you know. Just be careful whether you accept the vaccination or you don't accept it. There are families, Christian families, they've been separated, and the anger that is going in, they curse you if you have taken it, they curse you if you have not taken it. There's such a lot of anger that is in the hearts of people. People, the worst is in the church. People out there, you can't expect that. They will move with every wind of doctrine. But when you see it coming off the church and they're not talking to family members and cutting them off and cursing the churches who accept it, cursing the churches. Just be careful, church, that you don't get involved in this stuff if it's defiling you. And bless God, there are arguments on both sides, but don't get involved in it. Keep your heart right at this time, you know. Like even the words that were coming today, soften your heart, be broken before God, that broken and a contrite heart, and keep your heart clean with your family, church. Pray for them, because some of the families are taking the vaccine, some are not taking the vaccine, and then they listen to news about it. They don't want to listen to the news on this side. They you know, and they are angry with each other. As we come to the communion table, just examine your heart, church, and ask God to move in. Just look to God. He has the answer. Like I said, whether you took the vaccine or not, you still need the blood of Jesus every day. You need the greatest booster. I'm not upset about people having boosters either, by the way. You can have, you know, two or three boosters if you want to, you know, but there is a booster from heaven that you need to be taking. Mm. Whether you take the booster or not, you know, it's always available. The blood of Christ is so powerful today. Just believe that. You know, take communion for those people who don't agree with you. And ask God to reveal it. Don't allow these stories that are going on. Some of those stories, you know, I sense in my spirit, this is what I'm saying, some of those stories are not even true. You know, anyone can come up. People are lying about things, and they know people who have, this happened to them and that happened to them, and whether they took it or whether they did not take it, and all sorts of stuff. Thank you, Lord. Father, we come, Lord God, boldly to the throne of grace only because of your broken body and your blood, Lord. You said, Lord, that we could come boldly to the throne of grace by the blood of the Lamb, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the price that you paid on Calvary. Lord, touch those ones who are so bitter and angry, Lord God, Lord, with what's happening, Lord God, out there, Lord God. Lord, bitter and angry with their family members and angry with the media and angry with the premiers and angry with doctors and angry with themselves, Lord, angry with other Christians, Lord. I pray, Lord God, we break bread. You should not have any enemies. The Bible says, pray for those, even your enemies. Just pray for them. Do good to them. Expect nothing in return, whether they took the vaccines or did not take the vaccines. Go and cry out to God for them and keep your heart right and put all bitter root judgment to the cross, all judgment against any man, woman, or child. How could I say? The Lord's Prayer is very simple, church. Father, forgive me as I forgive those who do wrong against me. So there are people who have been doing wrong for thousands of years, nothing new under the sun. It might be wrong to you, but it's probably right to somebody else. Father, you come, Lord, and open the eyes of those ones, Lord. Open the eyes of their understanding, Lord, as we come and open up our lives, Lord God, releasing those ones, Lord, releasing everyone who have cursed the churches and cursed themselves and cursed their families, Lord. The negative words that have brought, Lord, division, Lord, that the walls will come down and the darkness will leave, Lord. Like Shamin seen, that dark cloud will leave. When the bread was broken, you know, when the disciples were running away, Jesus disguised himself when he broke bread, their eyes were open. Today we pray, Lord, that the eyes of the Christians will be open today, Lord, across the nations, bringing healing, Lord, into the body of Christ. I pray, Lord, the body of Christ will come together in unity, Lord, because of your broken body and your blood, that we will be quick to forgive, Lord, our families, our loved ones, people in other churches, Lord, whether they agree or not, Lord. We ask you for your love and mercy and grace to be poured upon all of us, Lord. Lord, we put all our opinions, all our judgment to the cross and put it to death today, Lord. They owe us nothing. We break bread for them, Lord. We break bread, Lord, for those who cannot break bread today. In Jesus' name, that healing will pour into their lives, Lord, as we eat together in remembrance that you took all our sicknesses, all our diseases, all our weaknesses, all our guilt, our shame, our condemnation. You took it all on your broken body, Lord. By faith we believe and eat together in Jesus' name. Yes. Thank you, Lord, for the cup of the new and everlasting covenant, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for the price that you paid, that you poured your love, Lord. You poured your life, Father, as a living sacrifice that we can enter, Lord, this very moment, Lord. That it's your blood that set me free. It's your blood, Lord, that washed my sins away. Thank you, Lord. We acknowledge and decree and declare it, Lord, not only for us, but our families, our loved ones. Lord, bring restoration into every household, Lord. Lord, the Christians, Lord, across the nations, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we will be one, Lord, because you are our daddy, you are our father, Lord. We take communion, Lord, for those who cannot take communion, that you will forgive them and release them, Father, that they will receive your love and forgiveness. Take away the guilt, the stain, and the pain, Lord. Heal the broken hearts today, Lord, as we drink together in Jesus' name. So don't forget, next week, church, Susan Hatton will be preaching to us, and she'll be on Zoom as well. So, like I said this morning, make sure you comb your hair and put the video on, because it's particularly, church, it's important while we are on Zoom as much as possible for you to keep your video on, because the messages are going on YouTube and people could be logging us on, 2 years from now or next week or whatever it is, and for them to see just dark faces with names on it is not pleasant. And it's good to speak to people who are watching you and looking at you, you know. So I encourage the lady when she comes. I shared this morning that, you know, we were on the 26th Australian day. We are 25 years we've been running the church, most of you know. So I think Janice has got something to share on Wednesday. Try and get to the prayer meeting on Wednesday. But the time for Suzette Hatton to come to our church is interesting, that 25 years we've been running the church, taking communion every day and praying every day. And she's a lady who has God used her mightily when she started off a ministry with Rana Bonnke to go into Africa. And I was saying hundreds or millions of people gave their heart to the Lord and God used her. She went a month or two before, Reinhard Bonnke went into the place and prayed, and there was heavy warfare and binding and loosing and getting the devils right out of the place. And Reinhard Bonnke goes in and he preaches and creative miracles, and millions, I shared this morning, there was 12 million people in 1 week who gave their heart to the Lord in 1 week in Reinhard Bonnke's ministry. So there was a tremendous foundation that was built by prayer. And I do believe that Suzette Hatton is not going to appear into our church and come into our church unless the Lord have led her. And I sense that God is going to use her mightily to speak over this nation at this time, because God is going to use this nation. This is the great South Land of the Holy Ghost, and it's been prophesied that revival, when revival starts in Australia, it will be the end of the end times, and you can sense that with all the darkness that is going around the world. But the good news is that the light is getting brighter and brighter. So put your lights on, put your switches on, and your YouTube on, and put your perfume on, and be on YouTube, and encourage when those who are preaching as well, not only Suzette Hatton, but Yara and all of us who are preaching. Don't forget the prayer, the transformation meetings from 6 to 7:30. And as I said, try and make it on Wednesday if you can't, the other days, and 6 to 12. Church, awesome things are taking place every morning in the prayer meetings. Deliverance, healing, people are being set free, things. I'll get Julie wants to share what happened to her yesterday. It was just outstanding, something that God has been putting on my heart, and things that I've been preaching for about 30 years now, and 25, 30 years. And the demonstration of that was unbelievable, and others were touched too. Allison and many others were touched by the power of God yesterday. So try and come into the prayer meetings, church. It's not, they broke bread daily. I can't say enough. You know, the earlier church did it because we need to eat. Give us this day our daily bread. Amen? Because we need the daily bread. Even the manna from heaven, they couldn't keep it for the next day. All right.
Just got word from a few people.
Sorry?
Got a word for a few people.
Yeah, go for it.
Rhonda, I just think about Psalm 149, with the high praises of God in your mouth and the two-edged sword in your hand. I just see a powerful, mighty intercessor. And in Daniel, it says, those that know their God shall be strong and do exploits. And I see a mighty woman of the Spirit. You're doing exploits, interceding, and there are breakthroughs. I just see that there's been battle after battle, and God is going to give you the victory. He's going to give you the breakthrough. You are got such a determination on the inside of you. And I just see for loved ones, for families, those closest to you, those closest that are on your heart, you're going to see breakthrough. You're going to see deliverance. You're going to see a new day dawning. Just see such a power and a tenacity on the inside of you. You're going to break through the darkness. You're going to break through the things that have been around about you. Father, I just thank you for Rhonda, and I thank you, Lord God, for Paul, that you saturate them with your love tonight, Lord God. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard and put him to flight. Father, I thank you that you're going to perfect the things that are concerning this couple, Lord God. You're going to move, Lord God, not by might, not by power, but it's going to be by your Spirit. Hallelujah. And Father, I thank you for John Martin tonight, that you are sharpening him. You're sharpening him, Lord God. He's been going through some trials, through some testings, Lord God. There's been some dilemmas. There's been some distressing situations, but you are sharpening him, Lord God. You are causing him to be a man that's going to go forth, a man that's going to go forward, Lord God. And you're going to part the waters. You're going to part the seas, Lord God. You are going to make a way for him, because you are a way maker, a miracle worker. You're the light in the darkness. You're going to light up your that situation. You're going to light it up, Lord God. Thy word is a lamp unto John's feet and a light unto his path. You're going to move mightily, Lord God, and he's going to see the victory. He's going to have the breakthrough. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you tonight for Chris and Usher, Father God. They've cast their bread upon the waters, and after many days, it's going to come back to them, wave upon wave, Lord God.
Lord, you're going to touch family. Family, Lord God, they got to testify of what you've done among the family, in the family, Lord God. Breakthrough, breakthrough, way maker. Hallelujah. They are going to know and have a revelation that you truly are a way maker. They call upon your name, Lord God. Amen. They live that life. They live that life close to you, walking with you, talking with you, Lord God. And you are going to demonstrate your power and your glory, Lord God. Hallelujah. You're going to do awesome things, Lord God. It's like I just get the word, stand back and see the salvation of your God. God is going to move mightily on your behalf. Hallelujah. And Rudol, I just see that you're a woman of faith. You're a woman of faith. Many times the enemies wanted to knock you down, knock you out. And I just see there's so many hurdles in front of you, but you're a woman that's going to overcome. Hallelujah. You're overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. Hallelujah. I just see you overcoming the hurdles, overcoming the battles in life. A woman that's going to stand tall and strong in her God. God is going to give you revelation, revelation for the next level, revelation for the next level of anointing, revelation for the next level of power. Amen. I just see a woman that's going to just take the presence of God wherever you go. Yes. The presence of God, and people are just going to be touched. I just see darkness leaving people's lives, oppression leaving. Repression leaving, depression leaving. Just see a power of God just beginning to flow out of you. Mighty woman of the Spirit, mighty woman of the Spirit. See you rising up. You're taking a hold of your children's hands and you're going to come in agreement with them. You're going to start believing for what's impossible with man is going to become possible with God. You're going to start believing. You're going to have a new faith that's going to rise up. It's going to rise up and you're going to see breakthrough. You're going to see victories around about you. You're going to see family members' hearts are going to change. They are going to soften. You're going to see answers to your prayer. You're a woman that's cried out to the living God. And in the natural, there's been times when you could not do a thing about anything, but God came to your rescue. There was divine intervention. God has heard your prayers. I just see the Lord going to give you visions and dreams. You're a woman that's going to take authority over the darkness, over the things, the negativity that's been going on around about your circumstances, and you're going to see breakthrough. You're going to see breakthrough because the Lord of the breaking through is going to come, will become reality to you in a new way. Just like David said, the Lord has broken through my enemies. You're going to have a revelation. God is going to break through. Through for you, through your enemies, and you're going to behold the glory of God. I just see the Lord bringing you into a new place, into a new place. The winter is over and the rains of God and the season of singing has come. Hallelujah. God's going to do some awesome things in your midst. You're going to see a turning around, a change of hearts. There's going to come something new that God is going to bring out of the ashes. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord.
Yeah, there, Bill, you got something for someone?
Came in a bit late, but I just kind of, just probably just a word for all of us, I suppose, but I saw, you know, I suppose through Jesus, we have a covenant with God, but I saw like so often in our hearts, we have this contract. And this agreement, you know, unknowingly, but I see this, God's showing me this written contract, and it's our plans and our wishes and our desires. There's these things that we have, but the Lord doesn't sign it, you know, and it's like we've got to rip that. It's our plans or our contract. And whenever there's tension or frustration, and it's like I just see this contractual agreement, you know, and it's like we keep bringing it out, but Lord, these things. And, it's like he doesn't acknowledge it. It's not, they're our plans. And so just to share that out so often, you know, and his plans are better. And just that, you know, it's only for us to be able to rip those plans up. So often when we come to the Lord, we're young and we don't understand, and things are there for us in the Lord, and the grace is there. And there's always these secret desires, you know, all plans for business, for this, for that, all these things, and all of them must be laid down. And as I said, the Lord shows me this contract that we have, and it's like we wanting him to sign it or to bless it. And yes. But the desire is he's wanting us to rip it up
and then ripping it up, we'll actually have his blessed for our lives. So it's kind of probably for all of us. So yeah. So that's it.
Amen.
Thanks, Bill. Hallelujah. That's so much true. Yes. You know, I've heard it before. You know, don't make the plan and ask God to bless it. Mm. Ask God what the plan is.
Yeah.
Amen. It's in the Lord's Prayer. Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done.
Beautiful little girl.
Let your kingdom come. So our will and our kingdoms have to go first. Then you say, thy kingdom come. Very good, Bill. That's,
yeah.
So is that all you got, Bill?
That's awesome.
Oh, dear. Word. Must have. just for Helena, just looking at Helena and just things are going to start to change. You know, you're going to start to spring forward, and you just got to open up. And you know, these words have been declared for you for a long time, Pastor Yara, and everyone has said these things. But I just see a freedom and a liberty. You know, you're just stepping out. Just adventures in life, adventures in the Lord, and just stepping into all these things. And I heard this morning Pastor Yara said there's gold in you, and it's just going to be coming forth and just unraveling. And so, yeah, I just see that for you. And yeah, it's just a breaking through where there's been limitations. The limitations are just falling away. And truthfully, most of them are just our mindsets, our beliefs, or things that we've accepted, and the Lord's removing it. And to see that for you. Amen.
Thanks, Bill.
It's a very encouraging word for Helena, Bill.
Just I saw a while ago, and it's right if I just share it, and we had two cats, you know, forever and a day. That 17 years we had these brother and sister. One was white, one was black, and the girl cat never really did anything, never said anything, just everything. The brother did everything. He meowed, he wanted the food, he was there, whatever was going on, he was there. And last year he passed away, and we didn't know what was going to happen to the girl cat. She was very shy and she was very meek, and people said, you know, she might fall into grief and all these things. And about 2 days went by, she came out of a shell. She suddenly realized that everything belonged to her. This house was hers, her brother was gone, and she changed, and she climbed over everything, every room, everywhere. She meows. She's just this different cat. And we know Tony's been to the Lord, going with the Lord, and we miss him. But I just, after that, God just showed me about our cats, and I just see for you that's just breaking forth. And not that Tony limited you or anything, but because he was there, it was like our two cats. And the boy was gone, this girl, she's a different cat, and she changed. And I kind of, the Lord always shows me that, and to share that for you. And like, there's nothing you need to do, but I just feel the Lord is going to really bring you forth. So and I felt he has already been doing that. So amen.
That's awesome, Bill. Very encouraging.
Yes. When the Lord does it, it's easy. Not by mind, not by power. Awesome. He's going to do it. Amen. So
awesome illustration.
Just step forward and he will move. All right. Paul has got a message tonight. Patiently waiting.
Well, actually, between Maureen and Bill, I think I'll just pray and we can all go home. It's just, honestly.
Yeah, so come up with the message.
Thank you, Lord. God gave me this a week ago, so I knew the foundations were there anyway. So thank you, Father. I just bring this night to you. It's obviously a word that you want spoken. You want the people to know that even as the worship was on tonight, as we draw closer to you and we become so much closer to you, because that is the relationship that you want for and with us. And we just give you thanks and praise and glorify your name. And I've done my hair. I've got a new shirt on. I had a shave. And because we're on HD, as Norm said, I even got the ear clippers and I cut the hair out of my ears so they wouldn't show up. I've even got my shaving aftershave on. Do I smell good for you, Ainsley?
Yeah, I can smell you. Yeah.
I didn't put the lipstick on because I didn't want to show Yara up. Praise the Lord.
Well done, Paul. Lord.
Thank you, Lord. The phone rings. And very quickly, before anybody even notices, a little voice says, "Hello? Hello? Is your mummy there?"
"Yes, but she's very busy."
"Oh, really? Well, is your daddy there?"
"Yes, but he's very busy too."
"Oh, all right. Is anyone else there?"
"Yes, the police."
"Oh, well, can I talk to one of them?"
"No, they are really, really busy."
"Is there anyone else?"
"Yes, the fireman."
"The fireman? Well, let me talk to the fireman."
No. "He's really busy too."
"So your mummy and daddy are there and the fireman's there and the policeman are there and they're all really busy. Well, what are they doing?"
"Looking for me."
Okay. I'm back. Praise God.
I didn't think.
The word for today is yes, dear. That's the title of the message, yes, dear. On Friday the 23rd of February, 1968, it was about 7:30 p.m., my life and my destiny was indelibly set forever. It was the night that I saw my life's partner, my eyes set on her, and that was it. Indelible, done. I was 16, she was 15. A couple of months later, after that very, and it was a very chance meeting, and we don't have enough time tonight for me to go through the details. I was even in my pajamas only an hour before that, when somebody said, "Let's go to a dance." So it was a very chance meeting because I wasn't even going to go to the dance. But only a couple of months later, I would ask Maureen if she would marry me. She was still 15. I, by this time, had grown up. I was now 17. The silly girl said yes. Then on the 8th of January 1972, 4 years after our betrothal, which was 50 years ago on the 8th of January this year, was our 50th anniversary, 8th of January this year, so 50 years ago we were married.
Glory.
But you see, the betrothal is when we decided between us we were going to get married. We didn't tell anybody because of 15 and a 16-year-old. Who would have believed it anyway? But, you know, there was a promise between us made, and that is called a betrothal. And a betrothal, if you look it up, says it's a promise that a marriage will take place, a formal engagement to be married. It's an engagement. We made a commitment to one another 54 years ago. And honestly, it was just, who knew how God, I mean, who knew God? 54 years ago. But our lives were sealed 50 years ago with a legal and binding union. And even today, I can't tell you what the instant attraction was. I can't. All I know is when I saw Maureen, she was the one. She was then and still is the most beautiful lady in the whole wide world. So that doesn't matter, right? But in pure hindsight, we can see that God had a plan. but only in hindsight. We couldn't see, we didn't even know God. Maureen didn't know God. I didn't really know God. I was a religious little boy then, but Maureen didn't know whether she was Arthur or Martha when it came to churches, because her mother had taken her to so many different churches. She didn't know, she knew the inside of a church, but didn't know what it was all about. But you know, it truly was. People say, is there such a thing as love at first sight? Well, I fell in love at first sight. I can't explain it, and I wouldn't recommend it. So if you're 15 or 16, I look at my 18-year-old grandson, I think, you're kidding me? I look at my 22-year-old grandson and say, you're kidding me? Well, by then we were having babies. Now, the world's changed a little bit since then too. But why is this little story important? Let me tell you why it's important. I'm now going to put my marriage celebrant hat on. Most people know that I am a registered marriage celebrant, and I've done lots and lots of weddings over the last 11, 12 years. For a few years there, I was doing 50 weddings a year.
Oh.
For a few years. I was the number two marriage celebrant in Queensland for 4 years running, voted by the brides. But I'll tell you, when you get invited to a wedding, when you get invited to a wedding, you're being invited to a celebration of a couple's marriage. You are not being invited to a marriage. I want you to just to take a breath, have a drink of water, keep up with me. I want to tell you about a wedding in the scriptures. John 2, 1, 2 says, on the third day, there was a wedding at Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. Now, we don't know anything more about this wedding in the Bible, unless Norman might be able to dig something out and tell me, but we know nothing about the bride, the groom, the family. All we know is Mary, the mother of Jesus, Jesus and his disciples were all there as invited guests to the wedding. You see, the wedding is for the guests. You with me? The wedding is for the guests to join the couple in celebration of their marriage. A marriage is between the couple only. And it results, I'm choking, the marriage results in the purest form of intimacy. My wife's word for tonight. And as the Bible puts it, it's when two become one. It's both a spiritual and a physical thing that happens after marriage, not at the wedding. That would be a pretty gross wedding. The wedding guests do not get to enjoy the fullness of the marriage as the bride and the groom do, but they go to the wedding. And most couples, and I've actually started to talk, and there's some couples probably listening to me right now who know that I've actually raised this point with them when talking about their upcoming nuptials. What value do you put on the wedding? I can show you the value. It's going to cost you tens of thousands of dollars. A wedding costs a bride and or groom or their family now over $50,000 is the average people spend on a wedding now. Over $50,000 for what? A 6 or 7 hour event. And it is an event, and good on them. But then when I say to them, what value are you going to put on your marriage? You see, if somebody came to you, single people, if I'd gone to Maureen and when I said to Maureen a couple of months after we met, will you marry me? I didn't say to her, will you come to my wedding? I mean, if somebody said to a girl, will you come to my wedding? She'd go, oh, yeah, no worry. Who are you going to marry? Because there is a vast difference between a marriage and a wedding. And we need to know this, especially where I will take you on this little journey tonight in about 3 more hours' time. You see, you got to know, girls, when you get proposed and he just says to you, will you come to my wedding? He wants a present from you. He doesn't want to put a ring on it. He just wants something from you. But you see, when God created us, God took one look at you and instantly fell in love with you. It was love before first sight, because he knew you before you were born.
Amen.
I didn't know Maureen before she was born. If I did, I would have known her for how old are you? Yeah, long time. But you see, God wants us to be his bride. He wants us to be married to him. He doesn't want us just to go to his wedding and enjoy the festivities. He wants you to be the bride. Matthew 22:2 in the Passion Illustration says, this is where it illustrated about weddings. He illustrated the reality of heaven's kingdom realm by saying there once was a king who arranged an extravagant wedding feast for his son. On the day of the festivities were to begin, he sent his servants to summon all the invited guests. And they even chose not to come, lots of them. They didn't want to go to the wedding. The bride and groom were going to be there. So the king then sent out, and you know the story, he did all sorts of stuff, and he got anybody in to go to the wedding. The two people got married, never changed. The guests changed because it was up to them whether they were going to be guests or not. And Maureen could have said no to me when I said, will you marry me? She had a choice. Silly girl. Smart girl. In Revelations 19:7, it says, let us rejoice and shout for joy. Let us give him glory and honor, for the marriage of the Lamb has come. The marriage of the Lamb has come. Not the wedding of the Lamb has come, but the marriage. And his bride, the redeemed, has prepared herself. You see, we are the bride. We're all the bride. Did you know that your own body is made up of trillions of individual cells? Each cell is a single component. Humans are complex organisms. Hey, look at me. You've known that for ages. I'm a complex organism made up of trillions of cells, each with their own structure and function. According to a recent estimate published in 2013, Annals of the Human Biology by an international team, they reckon there are 37.2 trillion cells in our bodies. We don't know how many people have gone before us. We don't know how many people come after us. We're not even sure how many people there are today. But the bride of the Lamb of God is made up of trillions and trillions and trillions of people who have been and are and will come. Those who accept the request of the groom, will you marry me? Yes. We then fit in as part of the bride, as our own individual. We're not all the same. We all are the bride, but we are all individual. So we can't blame people when they're talking about marriages and wedding. I mean, they get it's such a fun time and they get excited. But you see, a wedding is a one-off event, I hope. A wedding is a one-off event. It's a party. It's a celebration. In our Western culture, as I say, there's lots of eating and drinking and lots of fun, dancing, speeches, stories, some stories that people don't want told. But marriage is always was and still is, as far as I'm concerned, until death do us part commitment. It's a covenant. And we know covenants God is really, really good at. Because when his word is, he never changes his word. He never breaks his promise. You look at even the guests who came to who were invited to that king's son's wedding, they changed their mind. They didn't. They decided they were too busy. God will never be too busy for you. And when you've said yes, the covenant he's made between the groom and his bride sticks. You see, marriage doesn't start until the wedding is over. When the bride and groom leave the party, their marriage really begins. Because while they're at the party, they're still focused on the wedding. They're there to entertain the guests. Maureen and I have been invited to stay on at weddings after, at the wedding receptions after I've done a ceremony with people I haven't known. And we did it once. And after that once, we decide we'll never do that again. We get stuck at the end of a table. We do not know anyone, but people feel obliged to come and try to keep us interested. But, you know, we didn't even know anybody. A wedding is a relation, has relational festivities. A marriage is an intimate relationship. There is a huge, huge difference. So what does make, we've had 50 years. Thank you, Lord, for the 50 years. I've known Maureen for 54 years. But what has made our, if you like, what has made our marriage successful? Two words, yes, dear. That's it. And honestly, if you do that to those two words, then you're on the right track, because those two words can bring real joy into your life. And obviously, now that we're in the Lord and came to the Lord many years later, and it was a decade later, how I don't know how long, we came to the Lord, it is so much better. In Ecclesiastes, it says, in Ecclesiastes 4:12, and though one can overpower him who is alone, two can resist him. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. You get Jesus in the middle of your relationship, he will hold it together. You see, I've always said marriage is never a 50-50 relationship. You'll see the people, oh, marriage, yeah, that's 50-50. It should never be 50-50. If you're giving 50%, you're actually holding back 50%. By giving 100%, you're ensuring that all your love eggs are in one basket. You've got no spares for anyone else. You've got, you hear people say, oh, and how'd you go? Well, I gave 120%. Well, no, you didn't. You can only give 100, right? I know what they're trying to say. But if you gave 100% into your relationship, if I give more than 100% of myself for her relationship, I'm a winner. She's not going to be looking for any more eggs in any more baskets, number one. And why would she? Have a look. You want me to get close to the camera? Why would she? And why would I? I mean, when you got gold, why do you want to go and find coal? But you see, we all know the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13. I am not going to read it right now because we all know it and we all know where it goes. But when I first saw Maureen, I was hooked, and as I say, I don't know why. But when God saw you and it was a love at first sight, it was not a chance meeting. Ours was a chance meeting. Our relationship with God was not chance because he created us deliberately. Colossians 1:16-17 says, for by him all things were created in heaven and on earth. He's created. Well, he doesn't create something by chance. He creates it by plan. All things were created, visible and invisible, whether thrones, dominions, rulers, authorities, all things were created and exist through him and for him. And he himself existed and is before all things. And in him, all things hold together. You see, when he is in control, when his love is pouring out, he holds it together for us. So your relationship with God is not by chance. If you are listening to this, if you are watching this, it is not by chance. You might, as Ainsley said earlier, you might be listening to this 2 years after we've done it. And if you are, thank the Lord, because you're not listening to this by chance. God has a plan for you. God has a purpose for you. God loves you. He purposed you. Ephesians 2:10, Amplified says, for we are his workmanship, his own master work, a work of art, created in Christ Jesus, reborn from above, spiritually transformed, renewed, ready to be used for good works, which God prepared for us beforehand. Not accidentally. There wasn't a, oh, slips. Who made that one? Who do I blame for doing it? Did you see what you just did, angels? No, he made us beforehand so that we would walk with in them with him. God's love for you was and is more than we could ever know as love at first sight. Jeremiah 1:5 says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you and approved of you. You sit back going, who am I? How do I know if God loves me? I'm a nothing. I'm a nobody. You what? You're a nobody? This says God approved of you as his chosen instrument. How dare you belittle yourself and say that God has made junk? God does not make junk.
Mm-hmm.
And before you were born, I consecrated you to myself as my own. Now, I know that scripture. We could all say, yeah, but he was talking to Jeremiah. Yes, he was. And yes, by that, Jeremiah knew that he had a call in his life. I'm telling you, you can put your name in there as much as Jeremiah's name was in there, because God wouldn't do it for one person and then not do it for the rest of us. That'd be stupid. And God is not stupid. Now, most of us are adults here. I did see a couple of children. That's okay. But I want to talk to you adult to adult, big boys to big boys and girls. Now, you would have seen worse on the news, trust me, right? So don't get too excited. I hope you've understood to this point that there's a huge difference between a wedding and a marriage. It's very important. God wants you as his bride, not his wedding guest, okay? When Maureen and I did get married 4 years after the betrothal, and remember, a betrothal is as if you are married. Joseph was betrothed to Mary when God, by the Holy Spirit, covered her and she became pregnant. He, as you said this morning, Ainsley, he had a choice. He was ready to leave her. And the angel came and said, no, don't do that. Because as far as the law was concerned, they were married. But they hadn't gone to the next step of marriage, of conception, of going to the next step. But you see, the intimacy level, after you get married, the intimacy level goes from a different point from the betrothal intimacy, which can be hours and hours and hours sitting up talking for, you ask any young couple, in the first few years, they just sit and they talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. What about? They don't know. You can ask them next day, what did you talk about? I have no clue. But we talked for hours and hours and hours. And when we got home, now, I mean, back then we had to write letters. When I went away to sea for 6 months, two different ships, three-month trips, I wrote a letter every single day to Maureen. And the letters were on foolscap pages. And I wrote between 9 and 12 foolscap pages every single day. I had to number them because we didn't have a mail send off every day. We'd have maybe two mail pickups a week at sea and they would post them. Maureen would get 4 or 5 letters at once. So she had to do them in numerical order. True?
True.
So she would read, she'd be reading a book because I'd spent hours. Don't ask me what I wrote in there. In fact, I don't think they'd. Don't ask me what I wrote in those things. I don't know. I just, from the moment I woke up till I went to bed, I was telling her all about my day. That's what people, when they're in love, do. And yet now you get people who've been married for 50 years ago. When was the last time you spoke to her? Oh, does she talk, does she? Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, you mean I'm supposed to get a word in edgeways, am I? Oh, I didn't know that. But let me say, when we got married, our intimacy level went to another level. There's a different intimacy with a married couple once the marriage takes place. You see, my dad was really worried we were going to go to that place too early. So it was he that couldn't stand the fact that we were sitting up till 3 or 4 in the morning every day. Maureen lived with my grandmother and she would come on the weekends. We'd just sit up, talk. And my dad would bash on the walls and he'd kick the ground, he'd make noises, he'd go to the toilet 50 times a night. He didn't want to go to the toilet. He just wanted to check on his stupid son. That's what he wanted to do. And he came out and said, you two get married or she goes home. That's another story. But, you know, he was afraid of the intimacy level. But you, let me tell you about true intimacy. Once you get married, this is Maureen. This is where, who did this to me? Anyway, the intimacy level, true intimacy, real intimacy commands respect and generosity. It took many years of me in our marriage, many years of hedonistic selfishness before our real intimacy came into our relationship. And I'm not talking about a few years after we got married, you know, just the first couple of weeks, the first couple of months. I'm talking about decades. Decades before I put my wife first. Let me explain. I'm going to give you, this is what hedonistic is. To be engaged in the pursuit of pleasure, sensually self-indulgent. Decades. It was all about my needs, my wants, my this, my that, my something. I don't think for once I even asked, how you feel? Have you got any needs? We didn't have that discussion because it was all about me. And it wasn't a deliberate thing. I didn't go out deliberately. But my needs and desires were way up here to the forefront of the intimacy in our marriage. I mean, who knew she'd have needs? She's a woman. She don't have needs. I thought it was all about me and my needs in that intimate. Well, actually, it's not. So, and when I look back, there wasn't, I wasn't even given a 50-50 in that because it was 100%. I'm done. Thank you. Well, good night. Honestly, and I looked at it and I think, seriously? Well, she's still here, so she loves me. She loved me, still loves me. But one day, I actually realized one day it's not all about me. And no details, all right? But when I put that aside and thought, no, you know something, I'm going to make it different. I'm going to be able to lay next to Maureen without any agenda, any list, any outcome, with nothing, just lay there and enjoy her space and her company with me. To be able to touch her without expecting anything in return. Be able just to lay there and enjoy the love and company in her presence and to meet her needs. And you know something, intimacy is not all or always physical. When you have top shelf intimate relationship, just being in each other's presence, you know you're loved. Just a little pinky finger clip, you know you're loved. Being close enough, as the song says, to hear your heartbeat, you know you're loved. And you see, when God made us, he made us knowing how people are, but he's jealous for us. And, you know, Paul wrote to the Corinthians saying how jealous he was for them, for God, because he wanted so much that they would have an intimate relationship with their God. In 2 Corinthians 11, 1, 2, it says, I wish you would bear with me a while as I indulge, which is what I'm doing with you guys tonight, in a little foolishness. But indeed you are bearing with me as you read this. I'm jealous for you with godly jealousy. So somebody actually asked me the other day, I think it was one of our kids, are we allowed to be jealous? Well, the answer is yes, because there is a godly jealousy. But you see, God isn't jealous of us. He is jealous for us. There's a huge difference. If I'm jealous for Maureen, I want everything to be for her. I want my life to be, what needs does she have? If I'm jealous of Maureen, I'd have a private investigator out there. I'd be tracking her phone. I'd be checking the mileage on the car. That's being jealous of a person. Well, that's not how God is with us. You see, God is jealous for you. Why? Because he wants the best for you. He wants to meet your every need. And I realized that just about my whole relationship before God switched the switch, it was all eye-focused. And so many Christians, including me in the main, we're also not only physically hedonistic, but spiritually hedonistic. This is where Bill's word comes in. We pursue our own agendas and are self-indulgent in our prayer. We pray to God for our family, our healing, our miracle, our this, our that. Well, how's that all working for you? How do you feel? Make you feel better? Are the answers coming flooding in? Are you happier for your hedonistic prayers? And even when you do get an answer to prayer, do you then sit back and rejoice? Or you go, well, that's good, but hey, God, don't forget this one. And now that you've done that one, I expect the next one to be so much better. You've done that for me. Well, I want it better than that, God, because doesn't the scripture say, and greater things than these will do for me? So how are the hedonistic prayers working for us, Bill? Are we getting there? You see, we're always chasing the next high, even in our spiritual walk. Emma's told the stories before when she used to be on stuff. I've never had any, and thank God I've never done any of that stuff. It must be so hard because she had to find the next one and the next one and the higher. But I'll tell you what, you don't have to be on drugs. You can do it with anything. I used to have a gambling problem. I get paid on the Thursday, go to the club on Thursday on the way home and have no money left and had to borrow money to play on the pokies. And I wasn't even 18 yet. I was supposed to get thrown out of the club. And they did that as soon as I ran out of money. But I had to chase the high. I spent $100 chasing a $20 jackpot. Gee, that's smart. Our prayers are like that. And sometimes, now I'm being me, right? I'm just being me, so I never have to ask me to preach again. I've wondered if maybe we're not getting a lot of the miracles because if we did get the miracles, who would we give the glory to really? Would it be a wonderful thing that the Lord, look what's happening at Lord of the Breakthrough. Wow, this is God's moving at Lord of the Breakthrough. And I pray he really does. I sincerely pray he does. But are we giving God the glory for everything that happens? Or is it just, well, that's good, God. You're doing all right. You're getting there. You're nearly there. And it's not wrong to pray. We've just got to be sure. It's absolutely not wrong to pray. I've got more scriptures to come. But be careful your prayers aren't so self-indulgent that God has to switch off. You know who listens to your self-indulgent prayers? He stands in the heavenlies every day talking about you to God. Look at his prayers. God, I hope you're satisfied. And he calls himself one of yours. But if we pray as we're led to pray, and in the spirit is wonderful because we don't know what we're praying for or how. 1 Timothy 2:1. First of all, I urge that petitions, specific requests, this is from Paul to the church, prayers, intercessions, prayers for others, and thanksgiving be offered on behalf of all people. So Paul's not saying don't pray because you guys don't know how. He's saying get in there and pray because this kind of praying is good and acceptable and pleasing in the sight of God our Savior. So if we sincerely spent more time just focusing on him, giving him our attention, him God, not him me, not him you, not him, she, but him, God. If we're able to stay and even be quiet long enough, you never know, God might be actually trying to talk to you. When Maureen's talking, I've learned part of my yes, dear, is shut up. When she's talking, I'm not going to interrupt that. Get out of the way. That'd be the dumbest thing I'd ever do. But sometimes we've got to take a breath and wait and listen. Because God just might be wanting to talk to you. He might have an answer for you. And I figure if we put God first, just spend that time with no personal agenda, nothing. If I do this, God, you'll meet my need. If I do this, that'll be really good. You know what happens? Like my bride now. If I meet her needs, my needs are way, way above filled. And there's a joy and a satisfaction that I'd never known. I couldn't plan it because I'm not focused on me. And I certainly don't want to be waiting outside the venue, not even with a full oil lamp. And I read about the 12 virgins, 10 virgins, 5 and 5, right? 5 and 5 was 12 before decimal count. No, that's okay. So you got the 10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish, 5 had full lamps, 5 had empty lamps. They weren't full lamps, but they were still only guests waiting for the groom to arrive. I see it. I want to be the bride. I don't want to be a spectator at your wedding with God. I don't want to be there at the end and see all you guys going up as the bride and me sitting there going, how did I miss that? And God said, well, you're invited, but you took it as an invitation to a wedding, to a feast, to a function. So when the party's over, when the noise dies down, and there's that song too, and I was looking at that today, it's about 50, what's his name, wrote it. When the music's finished, when it's all said and done, when the bride and groom have left the venue, are you still going to be sitting there watching and waiting, wondering what's just gone on, thinking you've had a wonderful time, but now what? Or do you want, that's the wedding, do you want to go to the wedding? Or do you want your marriage with God to work and to last? If you do, stop asking what's in it for me. And remember these words. Yes, dear Lord. Amen. Father, I thank you for tonight. I thank you for the words. I thank you for the words that have come out. I just pray that your Holy Spirit would cover your people. As we, your bride, do come before you, as we prepare ourselves for whatever it is you want. Lord, I just give it to you today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Really good message, Paul. Thank you. Amen. Hallelujah.
Yes, dear. I remember this story about this guy who the wife was screaming and screaming and screaming all day, and she'd been going on for a long time, and this guy, and he kept on saying, yes, dear, yes, dear, and he was reading his papers, and her tone of her voice went louder and louder and louder and louder, and she kept on going, and she kept on, he's looking, he said, yes, dear, and kept on reading the papers, and he got so loud that he got off his lounge chair, and he went to the step, and he was reading his papers. She took a bucket of water and came and put it over his head. And he looked up and he said, after thunder comes rain.
Yes, dear.
Awesome, awesome message. Thank you, Lord. Amen. You need to wait. That's very good. The very, very good the way you bought it. It's not just a wedding, it's a marriage with the Lamb. And you've got to be ready for the bride has to get herself ready. Amen. You like to pray for some of the wives because you know what your wife went through when you were going through that stuff. You do come to that place in God, but there was probably damage to some of the women as well, you know. So would you like to pray for the ladies as well, Paul?
Mm.
You know who you are, and just open up your heart and let the Lord come and love you at this time
Amen.
Releasing those things. Thanks, Paul.
Thank you, Lord. Father, I do bring those ladies to you who have been subject to abuse like they've not known, and or those who are in their marriages even now, and Lord, that have been abused, but their husbands don't realize even that that's abuse. That putting themselves first, But I pray that each and every one that has been torn, Lord, and even to the point where they don't even want to say the word intimacy because it puts a shudder in them. Father, I just break that right now in Jesus' name. And I pray for each and every one that they would know that they can trust you, Lord, as they become intimate with you above and beyond everything else they could ever know, knowing that it is a beautiful thing to be in your presence with everything that you have, Lord. And I just break the power of the enemy over remembrance, over their minds, over their bodies, yes, those who have been physically and mentally abused. And Father, for the sexual abuse that's gone on throughout in not only institutions but the families, and Lord, even with their own relationships and their own relations, you know, fathers and uncles and grandfather, all those things, Lord, you know the ones who need a supernatural touch in their heart from you to know that they can trust the word trust, Lord, that they can trust you to be there for them, and that the hurts would be gone in Jesus' name. And Lord, as Jesus, you poured out your blood on that cross to wash away these things as well, to wash them clean, cleanse them fully in Jesus' name. And Lord, and I know with Maureen's case, Lord, she actually had to tell me that it's not. Things I was doing, even though they were right, they were wrong, Lord, because I was not putting her in the picture. It was all about me, and others have done the same. And Father, I just pray that the husbands would know to love their wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it and died for it. And Father, that we would know that if we put the wives first, Lord, that our joy will be fulfilled and full in Jesus' name. And I thank you for washing of the blood over these precious ones tonight, Lord, that they would know joy and know it fully, and they would not fear for their own children. Those mothers who have suffered and gone through things, and Father, they want to just protect their children to the point where the children don't even want to know some of them. And Father, I just break that in Jesus, that control in Jesus' name, control out of fear. We break it right now in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord, for your love. And Lord, your concern, you have a concern. It's a righteous concern for the body that they're running here, there, and everywhere, that they're looking to the left, to the right, and taking note too much, even as we've said tonight, of what media stories say. And Lord, we'll listen to any story, but we don't listen to you. And I just pray you would clear our ears, clear it of the wax of the media, clear it of the wax of the lies of the enemy, that those little nibs been going in there, that we would know your truth, and your truth will set us free in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
That was awesome, Paul.
Yes, just bring it all to the Lord and make sure you let it all go and keep your heart.
Some
ladies have really gone through a lot, a lot of grief and a lot of pain. They are sometimes they're hidden in there, but just continuously take it to the Lord that he will make you whole and complete and restore to you. Thank you, Lord. That's good training for Eli and all the other ones who are thinking about marriage.
You really touched areas there, Paul. Yes.
Very good. Amen. Training for reigning. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yes, dear.
What about me? What about me? What about me? Yes. Like Joy smiles.
There's a thing, it's called WIFM, WIIFM, What's in it for me?
Amen. That's a lot in that message. Thank you, Lord. Just fall in love with Jesus and let his love pour out of your lives. Thank you, Lord. Anyone else got something before we don't forget the prayer meetings in the morning?
All right. I got a lot out of that. Thanks, Paul, so much. And it's just quite amazing how just like even in my journaling, even in this morning, how I was just putting it to God and how I had to sort of repent, how I just don't trust. And I don't trust, like, the thought of me trusting a man again is painful for me.
Mm.
So that was really awesome prayer. I'm thankful for that.
Thank you, love. Thanks for sharing. Alinda, just, you know, the pain, sometimes that's really deep in and we bury it and get on with life, but the pain remains there. And a lot of wives are having that, you know, that pain deep inside.
Mm.
It's only the Holy Spirit that can go in there and heal you so that it won't hurt you anymore. You can live from now on.
Mm.
And let the Holy Spirit lead you and guide you.
Yeah, amen. Timely message. So I'm so thankful. God's always on time with things.
Yeah, very good. And what Bill said too, don't make the plan. And ask God to bless it. Ask God what the plan is. All right. Thank you all for coming. Thanks, Paul, again. Awesome message. God bless you. And another 50 years of marriage. Yes, dear. Bless you all. Love you all.
Bless you. Bye. Love you.
I don't know that I could keep it going for 50 more years.
Sweet. You can.
Give me that mountain. I am well able.
Do what happened.
Praise God.
Thanks.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.